أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم so inshallah we'll do ayat number 16 to 19 of surah yasin the context of these ayats is a conversation that is taking place between two parties and the continuity from the previous ayat is that in one township there were two messengers who were sent then a third one was sent there so three messengers having a conversation with the people of the town so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is quoting here their conversation which is taking place between the messengers and the people of the township So ayat number 16 is a statement which is being made by the messengers. Okay, so we'll do a translation. A'udhu billahi minash shaitanir rajeem. Qalu rabbuna ya'lamu. They said, the messengers said, our Lord knows. Inna, indeed we, ilaykum, to you all, means to the people of the township. Lamur Saloon are definitely the messengers sent to you. Okay. So they are reinforcing their statement that we are messengers from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and we have been sent to show you the right path. They further say in the next ayat, وَمَا عَلَيْنَا And it is not upon us, which means it is not our responsibility beyond illa means except al-balaghul mubin that we convey to you very clearly. That's all our responsibility is. We have been sent to convey the message of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to you. That is our responsibility, not anything after that. So these are the two ayats where the messengers are speaking. In the next ayat, number 18, the people in the town, they are responding to the messengers. And they are saying something very strange. They are saying that, Qalu, they said, the people of the town said, Inna tatayyarna bikum. We will go into very details of these words. They are saying that we are feeling, we are perceiving, we are seeing some evil omen from you, from the messengers. So they are regarding the messengers as an evil. So this is what they're saying. They are now in the next few words, they are threatening the messengers by saying, La illam tantahu, if you do not desist, if you do not stop this work that you're doing, you're teaching us all these things, so we will do something to you. What shall we do? Lanarjumannakum, we will stone you. We will punish you, we will kill you by stoning you. Walayamassannakum and will reach to you, will fall upon you, will touch you, minna from us, azabun aleem, a severe, painful punishment. So we will punish you very severely, very painfully, if you do not stop what you are doing, that you are trying to teach us, you are giving us the message or you are preaching upon us. If you don't stop, then we will stone you and we will punish you severely. So they said three things. First of all, they said, you have brought the evilness upon us, we see among you. Second thing they are saying, stop. If you don't stop, then we will punish you, we will stone you. So after saying this, in the next ayat, number 19, the messengers are replying to them. What are they saying? Kalu, they said, the messenger said, Ta'irukum ma'akum. Your evil omen is with you. Okay. A'in dhukkirtum. Is it because you have been reminded? You have been reminded and you're refusing. So basically, whatever evilness may happen, it is because of you. Then they are making one more statement. The messengers are saying to the people, Bal antum, nay, but you, qawmum musrifun, you are a people who are transgressing, who are crossing the limits and the boundaries set by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So basically, you are the ones who are having this bad and evilness among you. And these ayats continue, so but inshallah we'll do a breakdown here. So going back to the beginning of ayat number 16, the word qalu, it has been coming all along. Qalu is a plural. They said, it's a past tense. Now from the context here, we have to figure out who are they, because there is no name or a noun, proper noun, they said. But from the context which is going on, this word they said is pointing to the messengers. So the meaning will be the messengers said. Okay, now also, because there are three messengers, so it goes to all three said. Okay, because if grammar for one and two and more than two is different, qalu is more than two and there are three only. So qalu will apply to three messengers who are saying something to the people. Okay, what are they saying? Rabbuna ya'alamu. So let's understand, because the formation and placement of the words is very important. So the word is ayin, lam, and meem, which means to know something, common word. And whenever we put a ya in the beginning, this brings the meaning of a third person and present tense. So we will combine ya'alamu means he knows. Okay. Now, important thing is that if you are just reading this one word, the meaning is he knows. Now, at this, just by one word, we don't know who this he is. Okay. So now let's look another word that is going to support this, but the formation of that word is very important. Two things. If I put a noun before or an after, the concept of the meanings will be different. So let's first put a word here, Rabbun. Rabbun means Lord. Then we combine this with the na, and when we make mudaf mudafile, it will be our Lord. So the word will be our Lord. And this is the messenger's statement. So messengers are saying our Lord. Now when we combine these, one dhamma goes away and the word becomes, important thing is that only one dhamma is left. Rabbuna. Rabbuna. Now, this is a pronoun, he, but we don't know who this person is. The word right after that is our Lord. And this is a noun, okay? And this is a being, okay? So important thing is that you look at the harakat here on the Rabbu. If it is Dhamma, important thing, if it is Dhamma, Rabbu, and it is in the Quran Rabbu, then this whole world is going to replace this He. Okay, so the meaning will be our Lord knows. Okay, our Lord knows. Now suppose, just for the purpose of understanding, because pronouncing correctly brings the correct meaning. Let's suppose if I pronounce this word with a fataha, okay, Rabbana. In that case, the significance of this harkat here is this word will not replace this He. So the meaning will be He knows our Lord. Very different meaning. Okay. Our Lord knows versus He, somebody knows our Lord. So that's one very important thing, that this harkat of Dhamma here changes the meaning. So in the Quran, it is Rabbuna, our Lord. So as soon as we have Rabbuna, this He goes away. And the meaning is our Lord knows. Okay. Now, as I said, now the way I wrote it, Ya'lamu is first and Rabbuna is after that. So the meaning is simply our Lord knows. Now I'm going to take this word and put before Ya'lamu. So the word is Rabbuna. It's still Dhamma there, but all we did that in the Quran, this word is coming before Ya'lamu. So meaning is still same thing, our Lord. Okay, and is it still going to remove this He here? Okay, because of this Dhamma. The only place I moved in the front, it brings extra meaning by putting in the front. Now the doer, the noun is being mentioned first and the activity is being mentioned after that. Okay, when we do that, we bring the emphasis in the statement by defining the person, the doer, in before the action. Ya'lamu is action, knowing. It brings extra weight in the statement. So in English, how would I translate? It is our Lord who knows. I'm going to modify the meaning. It is our Lord who knows. By saying this, I'm saying that only my Lord or our Lord knows, other people don't know. Okay. So emphasis, strength in the statement comes when you put the doer before the activity. Okay. So these are the important points to learn in the Quran, because that brings a significance in the meaning of the Quran and understanding. So there, so far, Rabbuna Ya'lamu, it is our Lord who knows. Okay, now they are going to make this statement, the messengers, that what is that He knows? Okay. So now they are saying, Inna. First word is Inna. And Inna means surely we. And we have seen this word has come many times. Surely we. And we here is pointing to the three messengers. Okay, they are using for themselves the word Inna. Then their next word they are using is Ilaikum. So this is made of two parts. Ilaikum. Ila means to, and you. Now you is a plural and it is pointing to the people of the town. So when you write down together, it is pronounced as ilaikum, to you. Indeed, we are to you. So when you make a proper English, it will be surely, indeed, we are to you. Okay. So what are we to you? and this word has come few times, rasala are the root letters. In Babya of Allah, it becomes arsala. Arsala means to send. And in this Bab, when we want to make a doer or someone work is being done upon, you put a meme in the beginning and pronounce as mur. Then we take the next word, seen. And lam will have two dhammas. If we put fataha, that means this is the one being sent. If I put a kasra, this will be the sender, mursil. But mursal is the one who is being sent. So important thing is that. Mursalun is one person who is being sent. And when you make the plural, it becomes mursaluna. Many of them, and here are three, who are being sent. Okay. So now to emphasize, we are, Quran is putting another letter here, lam, which is called lam-e-taqid. Okay. Lam-e-taqid brings another emphasis that definitely, definitely we are the ones who have been sent. And the other word in English for someone who is being sent is messengers. Okay. So we are the ones definitely sent to you as messengers. Our Lord knows that we are not making it. We are not just claiming it, but our Lord, it is our Lord who definitely knows that to you, we are the ones who have been sent as messengers. So they are emphasizing by adding all these extra, you know, emphasis in the statement that they are definitely messengers. They are not any, you know, false people. Then after that, ayat number 17, they are adding one more statement. And what is that they are doing? So here, waw and ma, wama, okay? And waw simply means and ma means not. Okay, now the next word is made of two parts, ala and na. Okay, ala means upon or over, and na means us. So when you write down together alaina, it brings another meaning here. Alaina, okay, wama alaina, and it is not upon us. So what is the meaning? They are saying it is not our responsibility. Upon us means being responsible. So it is not upon us a responsibility. Illa, except, but. So they are specifying their function that there is only certain thing we will do, and after that we are not responsible of anything else. So that is the meaning of wama alaina illa. Okay. What is that certain thing that we are sent to do, and after that we are not responsible, is al-balaghul mubeen. So the root letters are balagha, ba, lam, and gha, ghain. Balagha means to, there are many meanings. Balagha means to make something reach somewhere or to convey something. Okay. The word tabligh is from the same thing. Tabligh is you convey a message to somebody else. Okay. Or balagh is also used for media, which is conveying something. Okay. So balaghun is the noun. Balaghun means conveyance, means sending message from one place to another place is called balaghun. Okay. So that is the word here from these root letters. Then, so conveyance, making reach. Okay. and then you put al. The conveys, and al will remove on the mm-hmm. mas, so it will become al balaghu. Okay, together this can be written as al balaghu, like that. Okay, this alif can be written as a short alif, meaning is same. Al balaghu, the conveying something, the message, okay, something that is going to be reaching to you from us is called al balagh. Okay, now, so this is the only word they're using. There is no other responsibility upon us, wama alaina, illa, except al balagh. Conveying a message to be conveyed, a message to reach to you. Make sure that the message from us has reached you. That is al-balagh. To emphasize this word, they are using the another word to bring the quality and the sifat or the naat or the adjective of this word is mubeen. So Mubinun is the word. Mubin is something which is very clear. Mubinun is full word. It is means something which is very clear. This word is from Bayyina. Bayyina means something which is very clear. And Mubin is something that has been made clear. So this is coming as a sifat or the adjective. And the rule is that this is a noun and this is the sifat or naat. This word has to follow this word. So if this word has al, this word should have al. Okay. And this word will have one dhamma anyway, so it becomes al-mubino. Al-mubino, al-balaho, al-mubino. The conveying of the message, but in a very clear way. This is all we are responsible. This is our responsibility. There is nothing else. Upon is al-balaghul mubeen. That is it. Nothing else. So they are saying, we don't want any payment from you. We don't want any admiration for you. We don't care if you reject the message and you will be punished. That is not our responsibility. Our responsibility is al-balaghul mubeen. So this is what messenger said. Now, in the next ayat, the people of the town are responding to the messengers. Again, the ayat starts with the word qalu, they said. But this time, they is pointing to the people of the town. Qalu, they said. What did they say? First word is very simple, keeps coming. Inna, indeed we. Okay? And we have gone through that many times. I want to spend some time on the next word. It's very important to understand. So the word starts with the root letters ta, ya, and ra. Among many meanings, one meaning is to fly. Okay. And something which flies is tair. Tairun means a bird. Okay. And its plural is tairun. But we'll worry about that later. Okay, so let's understand this word tairun. And what ta, ya, and ra is that? In the simple meaning that commonly which is used nowadays is a bird, okay? And the word tayara, which flies, is from the same root letters. Tayara means airplane. Okay, but what is the need for this word? In olden cultures, and obviously it's coming from Arabia, but in some other cultures also, if a bird in the morning comes and sits on top of your house, or maybe it is a black bird. So superstitious cultures regard that this bird who has come and sit on the top of their house is going to bring some bad luck to them. And that's called evil omen. Evil omen is something which is a bad luck. Okay. There. Now, there are many meanings of that. Misfortune, bad luck, evil omen. And for those people who know word nahusat. Nahusat, manhus, means this is a Urdu and Farsi loves word. Nahusat means the evil or badkismati or misfortune is going to strike that house because a bird has come and sat there on top of that house. So that is the background of these three letters. Okay. Now we will go to another bab of this one. And that is the bab Ifta'ala. Bab Ifta'ala. Bab number five. This is bab number one. We go to bab number five. And that is Tafa'ala. So what we do in that bab, we add a ta in the beginning. And it shut down the middle letter. So tafa'ala. So we can add those two letters, ta, and it shut down the middle letter. So we added ta in the beginning. And tafa'ala. That's the how it is pronounced. And middle letters are, the other three letters are ta, ya, and ra. Okay. So we put a ta with a fata and a shut down the middle letter. Okay. And put the same harakat. So what became tatayyara? Tatayyara means to see the evil omen, to feel, to perceive. Nahusat mehsus karna. Nahusat dekhna. So that is the word of the meaning of tatayyara. Okay. It going back to the same superstitious thing that a bird is going to bring. But again, they are saying that you are the people of the town are saying that you are the people because of you, we are going to see or we are seeing nahusat or evil omen or misfortune. Okay. So that is tatayyara. Now, when we make the grammar, fa'alna, we did, tatayyarna, we see or we saw evil but misfortune. Bikum, from you or because of you or by you. So what they're saying that, we were happy few people, you came in the town, you three messengers came in the town, you started problems, created issues here, you started people dividing among us and all those things. You have brought bad luck for us and we are seeing tatayyarna, we are seeing that you have brought the evil upon us. Okay, you have brought the misfortune upon us. So that is what they are saying. Bikum means because of you or you are doing it. So qalu inna tatayyarna bikum, the people in the town said to the messengers, indeed we see misfortune coming from you. Okay. So that is the explanation of this word is. Then they are further saying something. La illam tantahu. So let's understand those words. But before I go into that, this is a very special formation of the word. La, in, lam, tantahu. These are four words. Especially the word tantahu, okay, has a word lam before that. Okay. So I want to explain something about this. And I'm going to use the rule, general rule of the grammar, because then it will be easy to comprehend the understanding of the Quranic words. So if you start with these three letters, fa'ala means to do, okay? And taf'alu, when you put a ta in the beginning, taf'alu, it brings the meaning of you, one person. So meaning is that you and present tense. You do or you are doing or you will do. Mudare has both present and future. So the word ta brings the meaning of second person, singular, and present tense. Now we want to make it plural. So what we do, we add a vowel. Okay. So it becomes taf'alu. Okay, so it becomes plural. You, many people, do. Okay, now in the present and future, which is the mudare, we add a noon there with the fathas. This noon has a special name. This is called noon arabi, and there is a function of that noon. Noon arabi. This does not change the meaning. Meaning change, plural becomes by putting a vowel. But noon has to be added for a certain purpose, and we will see why we added the noon there. So actual meaning is taf'alu. You all do something, but by adding a noon, it is pronounced as taf'aluna. Now, let's see the function of this noon. So we are going to use this word lam, which is a very special word. Lam does three things. Lam has the meaning not. So it makes the sentence negative. You do, you don't do. That is lam. The second thing is lam calls jazim. Okay, what is jazim? Okay, jazim is from jazam. Jazm is, this little thing is called jazm. When you put a, this is a jazm right here, okay? So when we say it's a jazm, it goes and attacks this noon and makes it a, instead of fatha, it makes a sukoon or jazm, jazm, okay? Second thing it does. Third thing it does, this is a present tense, taf'aluna. It pulls the statement into the past tense, the word into the past tense. So lam does three things. So when we put the lam, it did the three things. Tafaluna, you do. Negative, you don't do. First thing. Second thing, it made it is jazim. Now problem is that when you have two letters next to each other, they both have sukoon, you cannot pronounce. So what we do, because we had added this, we just dropped this one. There was no purpose for that, except now we are making a word, a statement. Taf, so the word became lam taf'alu. Usually when there is a vowel, we add an alif, that's just a script for writing, doesn't add anything, okay? So that is what jazim did that. Then it pulled in the past tense. So the meaning was that you do not do becomes you did not. Okay. So this lam is going to do these three things to a important thing is that it applies to present tense, mudare. Mudare has a noon at the end, taf'aluna, ta'lamuna. It works on those. It doesn't work on the past tense if the statement was also a past tense, fa'ala, something like that, no. So keep this rule in mind because that's very important rule. Now, so let's look at the word. Now we're going to apply this to this word here. Noon, ha, ya. These are the root letters, we start with them. And the meaning of these is to forbid. Okay. Amr and nahi. Amar means command and Nahi means to forbid. Okay, so these are the three root letters, Noon, Ha, Ya. Okay, this is Baab Fa'ala. Okay, we are going to go in a bigger Baab, which is called Baab Iftala. So what we do, we add an Alif in the beginning and a Ta. So we are adding a Ta here, this guy here, and we are adding an Alif and became a bigger word, Iftala. Okay, so when we put this rule on these three letters, we are going to add an Alif in the beginning and a Ta, and the other three letters are a Noon, Ha, and Ya. Okay. So now we put the same harakat, it becomes In Taha Ya, and the last letter can be written as In Taha. This one. Okay. What's the meaning of intaha? Intaha means to desist. Okay. In Urdu, we will say baz aa jana, means to stop doing something. You are constantly doing something, you better stop doing it. That's the meaning of intaha. And intaha is also means when you reach to the limit of something, that's intaha also. Okay, so but the grammatical meaning is to desist, to stop doing something, baz aa jana, ruk jana, stop it. So that is the meaning of intaha. Okay, now we are going to apply, just like I explained it, tafaluna rule of lam, and tantahuna will become tantahu. So just do that. So this is the meaning, means to desist. Desist means definitely stop. Baz aa jana. Okay. So what we are going to do now, we are going to apply you stop. Yaf taf'alu, when you put a ta in the beginning, it becomes you do. So we are going to apply, put a ta in the beginning. And in this Baab, when we put a ta, we just drop this alif. Okay, so it becomes tantahu. Tantahu means you stop. When you make a plural, it will become tantahuna, buna. Okay, so it becomes tantahuna, tafaluna. Okay, tantahuna. Now put a lam before that. So tantahuna means you stop, or you desist, or you shut up. Okay, that is tantahuna. As soon as you put the lam will do the three things. Okay, it will make it a negative, and also will make as a jazim, and as soon as it makes jazim, this will fall off and alif will be added, and then pull in the past. So lam tantahu, you did not stop. The meaning will be you did not desist, you did not quit. Okay, now so that's the meaning so far. Now a condition is being added by saying that la in the beginning and in. Lam is surely, lam is taqeed. And in means if. So as soon as you put, so this together is being written like this, well, in. So that's where this starts sentence. La in. These two together written this way. Meaning is surely if. As soon as you bring the if, this whole sentence becomes a jumla-e shartiya, a conditional statement. And when there is a conditional statement, first of all, you know, then after that, you have a jawab-e shart, a response of the condition. But right now, condition is that if you did not stop. The people of the town are telling the three messengers, definitely, surely, if you are not going to stop what you're doing, you are keep telling us, Bilawal Mubeen, Bilawal Mubeen, we want you to stop. You have created enough problems for us. But if you don't stop anymore, now in English, we can also translate it, if you don't stop, okay? But the actual meaning is if you did not stop. So that is the meaning of La illam tantahu. Okay, so that is the condition they are setting. So jawabi condition, response is coming in the next word. Lanarjumannakum. It looks a very big word, but it's a very simple word. Ra, Jin, and Mim are the root letters. Rajama means to stone. Okay, and we also use this word when people go for Hajj and they do and throw the rocks or the stones on the Shayateen. Okay, that's called Rajam. Okay, but Rajama means to stone, punish, killing someone by stoning. Okay, that's what the meaning is, to punish by throwing stones on a person. Okay, so that is called Rajama. Okay, Naf'alu means we do or we will do. Okay, when you put in Naf'alu and Noon in the beginning, it becomes the meaning of we, and present tense or future tense, we do or we will do. Okay, so here we better translation is we will. Okay, so we do the same thing. You put a noon in the beginning, it becomes nar and jim and mim. Okay, nar jamu. The difference is that if you look in the dictionary, it will tell you that middle letter will have a dhamma, so you will have to put a dhamma. So nar jamu. Okay. Narjumo means we, and we are the people of the town, will, because this is the noon is bringing the meaning of we will, okay? And stone. Stone means we'll throw stones upon you and we'll kill you. So that is what they are saying. So this is the word here, okay? Now, so this is all. Okay, make sure we understand this thing. Very simple grammar. Naf'alu, we do. Narjumu, we will stone you. Stone. And Dhamma in the middle one. Okay. Now, notice that this is a Shartiya sentence. Okay. This is a statement which is the Jumlai Shartiya. So, Jawab Shart is coming here. What is the Jawab-e-Shart? Shart is that if you don't stop. Jawab-e-Shart is then we will stone you. Okay. So the stoning will happen if they don't stop. So when a Jawab-e-Shart comes, the statement of the Jawab-e-Shart has one effect. It looks at this word, which is the future tense, and always last. Naf'alu, last letter, has Dhamma, it changes into a Fatha. So the word became Narjuma. This happened because it's a Jawab. If it was not a Shart or Jawab Shart, it will remain Narjumo. But because of the conditional Jawab, it becomes a Fatha there. That is the rule of the grammar, that if it's a Jawab Shart, then it goes into the state of nasab, and last letter becomes fataha. This is all you need to know. Now, we are going to decorate this word. How do we decorate? We are going to put a lam in the beginning, noon shadda in the end, and kum after that. These are all additional words. This is called lam e taqeed. It means surely. This is called Nuna Taukit. This is surely. And Kum means you. You mean the three messengers. Okay. Read this together, and that's what the word is in the Quran. Lanar jo mannakum. Surely, surely, definitely, definitely, we are going to kill you by stoning. Okay, you is messengers, three. And the people out of the town are making this statement. It's saying that shart is that if you don't stop, then the result of that will be that definitely, definitely, we are going to kill you by throwing the stone. A long English sentence has been contained in one word, lanar jomannakum. Okay. Then one more thing will happen to you, which is simple words, meme, seen, seen. Okay. Masasa, mas, means to touch. It's also used in Urdu. Touch or to befall something or to inflict something. Okay. Now apply the grammar of yafalo, he does or it does. So this will become yam sasu. Okay. It means it touches. Or it will touch. We will use it because it's a jawab will happen in the future. So better translation, just like we did the narajo, it become it will touch. Okay. So this is also something will happen as a result of not stopping. Okay, so this is also a part of the jawab shart. Okay. So as soon as this is a part of the jawab shart, this last letter will change to a fataha. Just learn in the narjummo. Okay, so narjummo become narjuma. Last letter changes into nasab or fataha because it's a jawab shart. Okay. Now, so this is the word. Now do the same thing. Beautify this by putting a lam taqid, noon taqid, and kum. Okay. Layamassannakum. These two seen will be with the shadda. So there is a shadda there. Okay. If you write down all these together, it's exactly what's in the Quran. So the actual word is this, but adding surely, surely, and you. So what they are saying that definitely, definitely will touch you or will befall you or will reach you or will inflict you. That is the meaning of that. What will befall you? What will reach you? Minna. Min means from, na means us. From us. Okay. So now notice that when I put a ya, I put the meaning it and will and touch. And again, this means surely, this means surely, and this means you, three messengers. So here, the word is it. What is this it? We don't know. They're saying something will touch you. Now look at the next word. Next word, it has azab. Azabun. Important thing is that pay attention to the mass. It's a noun, it has two dhammas. Okay. If the word has one dhamma or two dhammas. It's instead of the rafa, and this word will throw away it. Okay? If it was two fathas, it will not do it. But it was two dhammas or one dhamma with an al, then it will replace this it. So now the meaning will be, azab will touch you. Okay? Punishment will befall you, definitely. And that punishment will be minna, from us, which means we will punish you. Definitely, we will hurt you, we will afflict you, we will strike you with a punishment, with an azab. And now, the sifat of the azab is being mentioned. Alamam is to have some pain or suffering. Alim mun is severe or painful. Alimun, painful. And this is coming as an adjective or sifat or naat of the azabun. So it's going to follow the format, which means if there are two dhammas here, there will be two dhammas there. There was no al, so there is no al here. So azab and alim are the noun and the sifat. They have to go together. So they are saying not only an azab or punishment will touch you from us, but it will be very severe, very painful, very hurting punishment will befall you if you don't stop doing what you are doing. They have threatened the messengers. So messengers just gave a simple statement. After that, they said, Qalu. Now, in the beginning, I wrote down this word, Ta'irun. So by after explaining all the definition that what the toyer does, toyerum means misfortune, evil omen. Okay. So and kum means yours. When you combine, it will become toyerokum. Your misfortune, your nahusat, your unfortunateness. Your evil omen. Messenger sign are saying to the people, this kum is for the people of the town. So messengers are kalu, they are saying, your misfortune, which you are going to see, ma'akum, with you, is actually with you, because of you. Okay? It is with you. Ma'akum. Okay? We are not bringing this to you. But you blamed us that we were bringing the evil omen, the nahusat to you. No, this is your own earnings. You don't think. So ma'akum, it is with you. Then the next statement they are saying, in dhukkirtum. So here is a question mark. In written that way, it's in that way, okay? And it is written together, in, okay, this way. Now, so this in, this is bringing the meaning of is it, question mark, okay? And in can be translated as because. So in means, is it because? They are putting a question in front of them that is it something because of something? And what is something that zakara means to remind? Okay. Zakara is remind. Zakara means to remember actually. But zakkara means to remind someone. Okay. Zakkartum, faaltum, you did. Zakkartum, you are reminded. You remind. Okay, let me write down so we know clearly what's the meaning here. So root letters are dal, kaf, with the shadda, and ra. Zakkara. Zakkara means to remind someone, to admonish something. Okay. To remind. Okay. Now, faltum, you did. Zakkartum, you reminded. Zakkartum, you are doing something. You remind. Okay. This is active statement. But if we make two changes in the harakat, if we make this a dhamma and this a kasra, it becomes passive. And the meaning will be, that's the word, dhukkirtum, you have been reminded. You were reminded. So that's how passive is made, that you change the harakat here and it becomes passive. And the meaning is that you were reminded or you have been reminded. So in zokirtum, is it that because you have been reminded, that is all we have done to you? You are making such a statement here, you're going that far. All we have done is we have just admonished you, we have reminded you, and because you have been given the warning, you have been reminded of the what will happen if you don't obey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, so you are making such a big deal out of it. It is that all there is, that the work was done of reminding you, that's all. And then they are making one more statement. Bal antum qawmum musrifun. So bal means but. Antum means you all, people of the town. Qawmun are a pupil, are kind of pupil. But what kind of pupil is? Musrifun. So let's look at this word. Sarafa are the root letters. Okay. Sarafa, ba, three letters. And its meaning is to, one of the meanings is to overspend, israf, or to spend something. Okay. If we go into Bab-e Afala, it becomes Asrafa. Now, here you can say you spend to the limit or to cross the limit. So the meaning is to cross the boundaries or the cross the limit or to reach to the limit. Okay. Cross limit. Had se guzar jana. Okay. Asrafa. Now, a person, how we make in this bab a person, we put a meme in the beginning. And make it musrifun. Musrifun. Important thing is that always to see what is the harakat on the middle letter. If it is a kasra, it's a doer. Means musrifun is a person who is crossing the limits, who is crossing the boundaries, who is transgressing. And if we put a fata here instead of this, it will become the one who is object, who is being worked on, but here it is the doer itself. So doer has a kasra, and that's the reason there's a musrifun, one person, plural is musrifuna. So you are the people, messengers are saying, but actually you are the people who are transgressing the limits, who are crossing the boundaries set by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So it is all you, not we, that are going to bring the misfortune upon you or nahusat or bad omen. So with this ayat, the conversation between the three messengers and the people of the town reached to a limit, ends here. After that, there is a story of a man who came running from the end farther side of the town, and then he said something. So we'll look into that next time, inshallah. Inshallah Al-Aziz, we will have a break for the month of Ramadan. In Ramadan, we don't run these classes. So right after Ramadan, I will send out the email for the next class that will happen. So may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept this from us and help understand and practice the Quran and help us and give us the blessings of the month of Ramadan. Sadaqallahu al-Azim.